This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Hi. Just before Dreamland starts, I have good news and bad news. The good news is it's an incredible Dreamland. The bad news is, and maybe this is because it involves the afterlife, this happens often, its video quality is really horrible, and we can't fix it. And I do not want to try to do this interview again because special things happened, and I'm not willing to try to sort of force that. So you can hear it perfectly. It's not a problem with the audio, but the video is definitely inferior, and it had something to do with our recording studio on StreamYard. I have no idea what it was, and neither do they at this point. They have not answered my query, but I'm sure they will, but unfortunately, it is what it is. Anyway, get set for an incredible edition of Dreamland. I get many, many books sent to me, many people asking to be interviewed on Dreamland. Every once in a while, something truly exceptional comes in, and we're going to be talking to someone who sent in something truly exceptional and has a truly exceptional life to talk about in just a minute. Let me read a paragraph from the book. I opened it at random, and this is what I first read. It was on our return journey that it happened. I glanced up, expecting nothing more than the endless expanse of blue sky. Instead, I was met with an extraordinary sight, a metallic saucer, unmistakably a UFO, hovering silently above us. Its surface was smooth and reflective, almost blending into the sky, but for the faint dark halo that seemed to surround it. Now, wait until you hear the rest of this story. It is not what you think. This is a story about life and death and more, and UFOs, of course. I want to introduce you to Matt Hendrick. Matt, welcome to Dreamland.
Hey, Whitley, how you doing?
Well, fine, thank you. I'm very, very glad that you're here. In a lot of ways, because you just almost missed being here altogether. Matt has written a book called Uncommon Vision, and I want to start at the beginning, and we're going to go through this amazing story together. Matt, let's go back to St. Louis, to your grandma's house, and to a certain tape. You tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, that was when I was eight or 9 years old, around that time. And I went to St. Louis to my grandmother's house with my mom. And she had gone to a psychic, and there was this tape that she had, a cassette tape. This was in the 80s. And she was bringing it to my grandma, and they were really excited to listen to it. And I had asked her, can I listen to it? And she said, absolutely not. I was forbidden to hear the information on the tape. So, of course, you know, when I'm just a little kid, I'm like, okay, I'm going to get that tape. And in the middle of the night, I went into her room and unzipped her suitcase and got the cassette and grabbed my grandma's tape recorder, and I went and listened to it. And it was, it was about an hour long, and about halfway through, the psychic says, I see one of your sons in a chair. And my mom says, a chair? And she says, a wheelchair. And my mom's like, well, that must be my younger son, because he's always had some problems with his legs. And the psychic says, no, it's your older son. So when I heard that, I was like, okay, that's the information I'm not supposed to know. And, you know, I was just a kid, so I kind of didn't really believe it or thought, you know, like, yeah, right, when I'm 80 or something, I'll be in a wheelchair. So, yeah, that's what happened in St. Louis.
So this is an truly extraordinary event, folks. Truly extraordinary. And we're going to take our first break a little early today, because I want there to be no breaks during the telling of this phenomenal story. Free Dreamlanders, we will return.
Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me. I am working on the first book to go into any reliable and accurate detail about the visitors' bodies, what they are like, how they function, and also how they relate to us, how their perceptual system works in comparison to ours, and what the disconnect is, because there's a major disconnect here. If there wasn't a disconnect, disclosure would have happened 50 years ago. There's a disconnect. The book is about fixing that disconnect. It'll be out as soon as I get it finished, before Christmas, I'm sure. If you've got any questions about the show, questions about anything, my weird life or your weird life, anything like that, DM me the questions. I'm here. I'm not far away, and so I will respond.
We're talking to Matt Hendrick. His website, hendrickmedia.com. His book, Uncommon Vision. And it's uncommon as it can be, believe me. Okay, let's fast forward now. Let's talk a little bit about at this age, the prediction, it had an effect on you, obviously. Tell us about, over the years after you heard the tape, how it lingered in your mind, or did it?
It did for a little while, but honestly, I was so wrapped up in sports and just being a kid, you know, just riding my bike, doing BMX and skateboarding, and I kind of forgot about it, to be honest.
Kind of forgot about it, but something didn't forget about you. It wouldn't.
Yeah.
Let's fast forward now to October the 19th, 1991.
Yes.
Rochester Institute of Technology is the setting. Tell us the story.
I was a first year student up there, and my mom came up for, she flew in for parents' weekend. It was, you know, the first 8 weeks, I think it's about 8 weeks into the semester. And, you know, she had told me she's going to pick me up early on Saturday. And we're going to go up to some area around the Finger Lakes up there. I'm not real familiar with that area, but she wanted to go do some touring up there and sightseeing. And she had a bed and breakfast for us. And so, you know, I got in the car and it was raining, and I had told her, you know, I'm not really feeling that good. I'm tired. And, I really wanted to just go back to her hotel and sleep. And she insisted that we go. So we drove, I got in the passenger seat of the rental car And I leaned it all the way back. And Whitley, do you remember those seatbelts? When you would get in and shut the door, the shoulder belt would automatically come on and you had to fasten the lap belt yourself.
Yeah, I remember. Sure, absolutely.
It was that type of system. And, you know, I was like, okay, shoulder belts on, good enough. I'm safe. I leaned the seat all the way back. And you know, somewhere along the way, we had gotten an accident. We still don't really know what happened. We went off the road and hit something. And we were only going like 25 miles an hour, but I came around the seatbelt. It flipped me basically. It saved my life, but it also broke my neck at the same time. And I wound up with my head where you would be sitting and my knees down where your feet would go. We hit the passenger side pretty hard. And the next thing I know, people are tapping on the window and asking me if I'm okay. And I'm just telling them that I really just want to sleep. And then I get a bunch of like just little blips, little slideshows, little video clips of what happened for probably the next month. And I had another one where I'm being hoisted up into the helicopter for the flight for life, and the nurse on board telling me, you've been in a really bad accident and your mother's going to a different hospital. By the way, she's okay. She wasn't hurt in the accident, but I wound up in a hospital kind of near Elmira, New York. And then I kind of wake up at one point and one of the CNAs or caregivers is working on me, and I'm like, you know, I got to get out of here. I got to get back to class. I got homework, and I was really into studying at RIT. And she looks down at my hands and she goes, well, there's a small problem here. And I'm like, what? And she's like,
yeah,
you're paralyzed. That's right. You're paralyzed. So I was like, wait, no, I'm not. You know, and I could move my hand. I felt like I could move my hands. And I was given the command, you know, from my brain to move my hands, and they weren't moving. And, you know, I just kind of get blackout from shock at that point. So, yeah, I had, go ahead.
No, go ahead. Go ahead. I'm listening.
So I broke my neck, and I became a C5-6 quadriplegic.
Meaning no use of arms or legs.
Oh, actually, quadriplegic is full or partial paralysis in all four limbs. So as a C5-6, I can move my shoulders. I can show you here. Yeah. And I can also move my biceps to bring my arms up, but I have no use of my hands. I have a little bit of wrist function, but I can't move them at all. So
that's rough, man.
Yeah, I mean, it takes
now for how many years?
I'm going into my 33rd year next month, or in October. So
yeah, so this is your life.
Yeah, you know, I've been like this for a long time.
Let's talk now about a near-death experience, because we're building a story here, folks. Remember that quote from the beginning when we started out, we're going to build a long story that's going to go in a lot of different directions, but don't forget that quote of that UFO sighting is central to this story. Okay, let's go now to what happened in terms of your near-death experience.
Okay, yeah. So There was a point. So I'm from Colorado, and they flew me back on a medical jet, and I got to a Swedish hospital here, and they were there was a lot of my friends, a lot of people from high school and college that I knew that, you know, were all there to support me and see me as I, you know, came from the medical jet to the hospital. And it was pretty quick where they wanted to rush me into a surgery to put a halo device on my head. I don't know if you've seen those, but it's where they drill holes in your forehead and the back of your head and put this real weird looking device on there. It's called a halo. It's pretty horrific. I like to tell people it's not, you know, it stabilizes your head, but all you can do is move your eyes around and stuff. So I think it was during that surgery where all of a sudden I'm going up, you know, your tunnel of light that you hear about frequently, and it's very comfortable and inviting and warm, and just there's no sensation, you know, there's no hot, cold, your body doesn't hurt it. I just remember going, well, I'm out of my body and I'm free from the problems of the body. And there's a white light at the top, like a circle, and there's three shadows up there, like silhouettes. They look like human silhouettes, and the voices, they were talking to me. They're just regular, they sound like regular humans, and they're just encouraging me to, you know, give up, this one's over. You know, there's nothing you can do, just give in to it. You're welcome to come back up here. And I'm like, wait, I'm not ready. You know, I don't want to go. And they're like, well, you know, you kind of have to, there's no choice here. And so I'm, you know, going straight up and up, and I'm like, but wait a second. Look, have you seen how many hot women are coming to visit me? All the girls from high school and college and stuff. And they laughed. They laughed hard, and all of a sudden I went zipped right down into my body, back on whatever table I was on. And you know, I kind of blacked out after that, but that was my first near death experience.
First near death experience. The interesting thing about this experience was it's the opposite of most people, in the sense that you were said, they were saying, you're done, come on, you're finished, you don't have to do this anymore. And you were saying, no, I'm not ready, I'm going back. And you were, did you know that you were going back to a catastrophically damaged body?
I don't think I realized that now.
Would you have come back, do you think, if you had known that?
You know, that's a good question. And I'll have to say, I don't think I would go back. After all these years, yeah, I should have went, but.
But you didn't. You came back.
Yeah.
And now here you are, and maybe fulfilling a role that you... you were destined to fulfill in a way.
Yeah.
Even though you could have left.
Uh-huh.
So now can you sent during the medical flight, this was already sort of beginning to happen, and you felt a sense of detachment, as I recall.
Yes.
Detachment. You knew that you were paralyzed.
Correct, yeah.
And you felt this sense of detachment. And then the next thing you know, you have a this NDE. And now, tell us about your mother's role in all of this. I mean, she's had this accident. This terrible thing has happened to her son. How does she react?
Oh, she was, heartbroken. It's the last thing that any mother would want to have happen with their oldest son. And, but that tape, that the psychic thing, we didn't even really, we didn't connect the dots for many years after that. But, she basically said she would devote her life to helping me, with getting resources and doing anything we can to repair or find cures and stuff like that. And, we were on it for many years trying to research everything, but after a while, it just becomes normal.
It becomes your normal life.
Yeah.
Now, at this point, you're struggling with this, and you lose everything, your sense of purpose, horrible adjustment to life as a quadriplegic. And how do you cope with that?
It's not easy. I mean, one week I'm in New York and I'm really independent and I'm learning a lot. And I had just met Annie Leibovitz, was in one of our classes for teaching us some stuff. I was in the photography program there.
Yeah, Annie Leibovitz is a famous photographer, a wonderful photographer.
Yeah, yeah.
She's also great. Also an extremely interesting human being.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She gave us a lecture on how to get your subject to do stuff that they normally wouldn't do. So, that's really cool.
Yeah. So now you're not, obviously, that life is not.
Yeah. It's gone. I'm sitting back. Well, I was in the hospital for 6 months. And then, you're like, I want to go home. I need to go home. As soon as you get home, I'm sitting in my parents' house in their living room. That's the only room that's on the first floor. And now that's my bedroom with a hospital bed and a wood floor in there. And it's a pretty small room. And, I made it through, but I was meeting Annie Leibovitz, and now I'm paralyzed back in my parents' house. That was very hard to deal with.
I can't imagine. Yeah. I'm sure no one can who hasn't dealt with that, and it would be very disingenuous to say, "Oh, yeah, I can imagine that," because I can't. Well, let's go back to the NDE, because there's a lot of energies in this story that are not, like right on the surface, but I want to talk a little bit about I'm looking at the book here now on my iPad, and as soon as I picked it up, I lost my place. So you were pulled back. You went back into your body kind of violently.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so tell me about I'm trying to get to a question here, and I lost my place. Okay. Once you've had the out of body experience, you begin to sense a new sense of purpose, as if a new kind of energy has come into you.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Tell us about that.
Well, you get, you feel like you just really want to survive. A lot of that didn't dawn on me until much later down the road, maybe 6-7 years later. Mm-hmm. 'Cause a lot of there's a lot to learn about being a quadriplegic. And they teach you in 3 months, like what would take, you know, like a, it seems like a 10-year college degree that you get in 3 months. You have to really learn a lot. And you're also dealing with all the psychological stuff, you know, all the, you know, why me? Why couldn't I have just broke my back and been a paraplegic? Why, you know, there's a lot of whys involved, and how, you know, and you start thinking about, you know, how am I ever gonna, you know, work again or go to school or, you know, have a relationship, or am I ever gonna get married? Can I have kids? You know, your whole frame of mind just changes immediately. So I really had to deal, you have to process some of that. And I think it takes about 5 years. But then, you know, some of the stuff that you're talking about, the, you know, the energies and the, you know, like trying to have a purpose, trying to understand what life is really about, that kind of came about. I got a dog and a cat, and I had a lot of plants, and I just really didn't want to be around people that much, but I really liked to be around all that stuff. And I kind of learned, you know, just the, you know, just to learn a different pace of life.
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah.
There was one point at the hospital where a doctor said a rather surprising things to you. The doctor said that there was no reason that you should be paralyzed. Why did he say that?
Yeah, because, well, that was the last day I was in rehab, and he brought me into his office, and he showed me an MRI of my spinal cord. And he goes, you know, he looked at it, and he's like, there is really hardly any damage here. And the way I presented myself with the paralysis, he's like, it's not really matching up how it should. So he, you know, he's like, he didn't want to tell me that I would recover, but he kind of thought that I might. You know, he doesn't want to promise anything. But I never did.
Yeah, and yet it's an unusual situation. The spinal cord has not got any clear damage, and yet this happened. It's like your fate in a way. It's a very strange story. When you get beneath the surface of the story, this is more than a story about a guy in an auto accident. And that UFO, we're going to get to that in a few minutes. But before we get there, folks, let's take our break for our Free Dreamlanders. We'll be right back.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it. And I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives. UnknownCountry.com subscribers have access to a vast treasury of information. Listen to what Dr. Robert Schock said. He's an expert on the past, and for that reason, he also knows a great deal about the future.
We are re-entering, as you say, a debris field, and when you have a debris field like this, it enters the solar system, it energizes the solar system as you have things going into the sun, even clouds of dust particles, for instance, it will energize the sun, it will destabilize the sun. This is what we saw at the end of the last ice age, in approximate terms, about 13,000 years ago.
And just in the past few days, more enormous meteors have been sighted, and this goes on continuously, more and more every year. We live in a time of great change in a world that doesn't like to look at things as they are. UnknownCountry.com offers extraordinary information, a vast archive that you cannot find anywhere else. Subscribe today. Help keep this website going, because without you, there is and can be no us. Go to unknowncountry.com right now. Click on the subscribe tab. Get started.
All right. Now, you have a... let's talk a little bit about the UFO. Tell us about when it was seen and at what context you saw it. And I believe you were not alone.
No, I wasn't alone. And this was in the year 2001. So 10 years after the accident. And I was very adjusted to the injury. And I had bought a Toyota 4Runner that year, and my brother could pick me up and put me in the passenger seat and throw my wheelchair in the back. And my mom had, she had moved down to a ranch in a little bit south of Pueblo in Colorado, and kind of by the San Juan Mountains, a little east of there. And we went down there to visit her for a couple days and show her the new Toyota 4Runner. And, you know, she had 40 acres. And we all four got in, my stepdad, my brother, and my mom. And we just took a drive, did a little four wheeling on their property. And, at one point we were kind of coming back, and I just look up and there it was. And I'm like, do you guys see that? And, you know, everybody saw it. They could tell what it was, that, you know, that it was a UFO. We all kind of agreed on that. And it was pretty close to us, to be honest. And it was like metallic, and it kind of had a little, like a faint, like a dirty cloud around it kind of thing. And I immediately thought, oh, they must be using diesel fuel for propulsion.
Yeah, probably not. had anyone else in the family or you ever seen anything like that before?
No, not at all.
Not at all.
No, we never even had any interest in that or anything. You know, back in the 80s, it was a little rough, as you know.
I'm aware of that. It was a little rough, all right. I became, everybody knows what happened to me. I'm still here, though, boy, and so are you.
Yeah.
So you see the UFO, and what do you do then? What happens then? Did it just disappear, or what happened to it?
Well, I had a camera. I had my first digital camera sitting on my lap. It was a Nikon Coolpix 950. Those are really cool cameras. But I didn't even, there's no way I could lift the camera up to take a picture of it.
No,
but I didn't even think to ask anyone else to do it. I was just staring at it like, I don't want to stop looking at it or it's going to disappear. And then it sort of just faded away, disappeared.
Strange thing. Faded out like a dissolve in a movie, or it suddenly was gone?
It's sort of a dissolve, yes.
Wow. If you ever had any sense of why it was there, why it showed up?
No, not at all.
You do know about the connections between our own dead and these UFOs and the visitors. That's all kind of wound up in the same ball of string.
I do. Now I do. I've learned quite a bit.
Yeah, yeah. This sets you on a path, I'm sure, of more discovery.
Definitely curious, yeah.
And yeah, so what did you do then? I mean, what did the family do? Did you all talk about it, or?
Well, I tried to talk to them about it, and they really were, they didn't want to talk about it. They didn't want to admit that they saw that, you know, and I was like, whoa, this is crazy. We gotta do something here. We gotta, you know, let's go figure something out. But, you know, I wanted to learn more. I was very curious after that. And I was a little upset with them that they were sort of like hush hush about it.
And they were, and over time, what happened? They just forgot about it, or what happened?
They just would never really, they just go, yeah, I remember that, you know, that kind of thing. And I think my brother one time said, yeah, I always thought that was just a weather balloon. I'm like, a weather balloon? Come on. It was way different than, you know, a balloon. And it seems like he had just heard that somewhere, maybe from, you know, the old Roswell excuses and stuff like that. But they were not into it like I was.
You know, the interesting thing is that these devices, they're, what was there was such an extraordinary thing. It chose you to add, activated you, but the others weren't needed. And so they were left unactivated, and it drifted out of their lives. Do you suppose they remember? I guess they still remember it, but only it's not important to them.
Yeah. It was just like they saw like a deer or something on the side of the road. No big deal.
And yet, yeah, it was a big deal. Now, the next thing in the book, you begin to talk about spiritual exploration. And I don't recall, I'm not looking at the actual book at the moment. Is there a connection between the UFO sighting and the spiritual exploration that you began?
I think so, because I wasn't thinking about any of that prior to the UFO sighting. So almost immediately when I got home, I started really having an interest in Buddhism, which is, you know, it's not anything I'd been studying or had learned about as a child or anything like that. And I got aggressively searching for groups, meetups. I met a group of Tibetan Buddhist people in Denver, and I started taking some classes with them, and I learned the Hinayana and the Mahayana, and started doing some of the Vajrayana, and learned some Reiki, some of the healing stuff, and I did a couple past life regressions. I really went towards that type of stuff, which wasn't real normal for me prior.
What's interesting here is that you chose Tibetan Buddhism in particular, because Tibetan Buddhism, uniquely in the various Buddhist traditions, is the one most concentrated on the afterlife and on the different bardos, and the bardos of this life and the bardos of the afterlife, and these stages of being. And I just see the UFO coming, and it specifically activates you in that car and nobody else. And then the next thing we know, you're on a spiritual journey toward a deeper understanding of the bardo.
Yeah.
It's like they're saying, well, you know, you were supposed to come and you didn't, and now we're going to teach you what this is all about, so that when you get, when it comes time again, you won't put up a fuss.
Yeah, I mean, you could look at it that way for sure.
Yeah. So now you get into past life regression. See, there's a fascinating arc here. This guy has a terrible accident, a near-death experience. He struggles for years building himself again, refuses to leave in the near-death experience when any fool would say, holy shit, thank God I'm out. And instead, he comes back and he goes on this amazing journey. And that's why we're on the show together, because we want to know about these journeys, because there's not a, probably not a single listener who is not wanting to take a journey like this. And you know something about this kind of journey because you have been taken on your journey by a higher power. And yeah. Maybe you didn't look at it that way, but that's what happened. So you get into Tibetan Buddhism, but you then go beyond that. Let's talk about past life regressions and things like that. Why did you even think about getting a past life regression?
Well, I wanted to do all the stuff that was, the energy type work. They had this thing in Colorado, in Denver, called the Colorado Free University, and they would offer classes and stuff. And I got their catalog and I'm like, oh, what's this past life regression? What's this Reiki? Let's learn about. So I would go to these like introductions to these subjects, and they would have people, but people that would have books out or have services that they would kind of give you, get your feet wet, so to speak, and they'd give you a little brief introduction on these things, and then I would go deeper. And what I did do a past life regression, and I honestly, when I went into the it was a kind of a group, there's four or five of us, and when I went in, I was like, okay, I'm not sure if this is gonna work. And she said, at the end of our time here, we're gonna all report what we saw and what happened. And so in my mind immediately, I'm like, oh no, I gotta come up with something right now. I'm gonna tell them I was a baseball player in the 1920s and I saw myself striking out or something like that. I'm like, okay, I can tell them that. I didn't have much faith that it was gonna work. Right. And we go into it and, oh my God, all of a sudden I'm like, I'm in this world where everything is so clear and it just felt so real. I could feel the sun on my body. I could hear birds chirping. Everything was very peaceful. I was kind of looking down at my legs and I was above a battlefield, with just dead bodies and horses and, blue and gray uniforms everywhere and, swords and all kinds of stuff. But the sun was shining. Everything was peaceful. It was so strange. I was up pretty high. And when I came out, I reported to the group, and the lady, her title was the shift guru, if I remember right. And she said, that sounds like you were in the American Civil War. And a lot of times people remember their most violent death. And it sounds like something, she thought maybe I was hanging because I was looking down at my feet from pretty high up. And that was one of my first experiences where, it's not reality. It's like, but it's not like a dream,
I have those experiences. I think a lot of us have those experiences. It's not what they call a lucid dream. It's not reality. Yeah. At least it's not reality, this reality. And so where do you think you were? You think you were a, what were you, like some soldier who got hanged or?
That's my conclusion, yeah. Something.
Yeah. A lot of us have numerous lives that involve bad luck. I know I do. I have, and you're right about the memories of past lives often being of violent deaths.
Yeah.
Like I remember dying in a chariot race in Rome. I was a charioteer and came around a bend too quickly, and that was it. And then another one where I'm very confused because suddenly I'm in a park with these palm trees, and they look fake. They don't look like real trees, and I'm very confused. And the next thing I know, a lion comes around the corner and grabs me under the shoulder here. I can still, to this day, feel it. And I realize there's a roar, and I realize I'm in a crowded space, and this is all a set. And I'm being devoured, but the lion is no set. He's real. Then there's one about being gut shot back in 1945, and then one of catching on fire in an airplane in World War I. It's all, and they're all like that. I mean, you know, where the unusual past life experiences are the ones where we remember a past life that had a quiet death, actually. Now, let's move on. We've got you. What's happened is your life has been reframed. The UFO sighting wasn't no accident. That was somebody who cares about you came to reframe your life, which is why you're here. Because as soon as I saw that part of your story, I don't think you fully understood what had happened, but that's what happened. Now, let me ask you this. If I just say to just let go and just riff on it, tell us what comes to mind about who may have been in that UFO, if anything. If nothing does, nothing does.
Oh, I feel like I'm part of a group of people that are participating in something that we're doing here. And when we're in our bodies, we don't really know that we're part of that. And I think the people in the tunnel of light and the beings in the craft, I feel like I'm related to them, like there's some sort of family. And I also, for some reason, I feel that when people that are close to me die, that they kind of go back to that group. That's just me speaking off the top of my head, kind of where I feel. I didn't really write that in the book, but.
No, but I recognized it immediately. What you're talking about is your soul group. This is one of the most interesting things about your story, is that normally the soul group is invisible. You don't see the soul group, and you don't experience the soul group while you're in this life. But like my wife said, after she passed on, it looks like you're all intentionally ignoring us. And we are. We are intentionally ignoring you, because that's not why we're here. We're here to experience the new all the time, to get the wash of time passing over us, and every experience is new, and we're gathering energy from that. And this is a very important chance to be able to do this. And you don't want to look outside of the time stream, because when you do that, that's like being dead. Your whole reason for being here ends. So your soul group is generally trying to maneuver you a little bit through the time stream so that you'll get the kinds of experiences that you want. And what's so unique in your case is you were ready to leave. They were ready for you to come. And you said you come back. And not only do you come back, you begin to build life lessons and a book that helps a lot of other people. This is a very energetic and heroic act on the part of your soul. You're not directly in touch with that now. It's because we're not in touch with that level of our being. But your soul, when you decided to come back, your soul knew what you would go through and decided to do it anyway. And that's another reason you're here, because I want that soul to be able to express it into the world what it came here to try to, it came back to try to express, because you've paid for this, man. You paid big. You're sitting there like that, so you can do this. I'm very much in admiration of you. I think you're a real hero.
Thank you, Willie.
So, okay. Now we go on. Here's you have a caregiver. Tell us about the caregiver and tell us what happened.
Which one?
The one who, the sudden absence.
The absence?
And then there were strange occurrences in the house.
Oh, yeah. During COVID, I had to cut down. I usually have 6 caregivers. I've had so many over the years. And I did talk about a few in the book. That's why I'm like, which one?
Yeah.
So I think I know which one you're talking about. During COVID, I cut down to 2 so that we wouldn't, in case someone got COVID, we wouldn't give it to everyone's families and stuff. And
right.
This gal, her name was April. She came to the interview and I said, tell me something about you that you want to tell me, And she goes, well, I guess I always wanted to see an alien. And she pulled her lip down and she had an alien tattoo inside of her lip.
Oh my God.
And I was like, well, that's cool. And I told her I saw a UFO once and I'm like, okay, I'm going to hire this one. I like her.
Yeah, I bet.
Yeah. So we went down the rabbit hole with all any documentary, anything we could find during COVID, and we watched anything on YouTube, Netflix, Amazon. We got on Gaia TV and all that, and we just were soaking it all up while we were working, while she's working on me and stuff. We would watch this. We learned about CE5 and Stephen Greer, and so we started watching those documentaries he does. And we watched Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind, and we got his app, and we would go out and sit out on the deck at night and play some of the binaural beat noises that are in there.
Yeah.
And look at the sky and stuff, and nothing happened. Nothing happened in the sky, but what was really peculiar was I noticed my dog was like sniffing around and doing like circles around on the deck. And I'm like, oh, that's weird. That I've never seen that before. So there was, it felt like something was there, but it wasn't, UFOs coming in the sky like we were thinking would happen. We did that for like 2 weeks and we kind of gave up, not much happened. And then she would, she would stay over here, and I have a guest bedroom for them. And she would put me in bed and then get me up in the morning. And when she was making me some breakfast, I went back out on the deck, and it's like 11 o'clock in the morning. And I look over to my right, and there's these 3 orbs just kind of loosely in a triangle formation, 1 on top, 2 on bottom. And they were kind of bouncing around, and I'm like, whoa, what is that? And they look like metal pinball kind of looking things. And in the middle was sort of churning. It was almost like hypnotizing. It was really strange. And I'm like, April, get out here now. They didn't show up last night. They're here now. And she came out and she was, you know, we watched them and she's like, it was funny, Whitley, I'll tell you, she's like, I don't like it. I don't like them. I'm like, what do you mean you don't like them? She's and then she was acting like she was forgetting. She was having a hard time with it.
That's because she's not, it wasn't her soul group. And if it's not her soul group, she doesn't belong there. Now, speaking of belonging and not belonging, pre-Dreamlanders, I'm so sorry to tell you this because it's such a fabulous show. We got to say goodbye to you. Subscribe to the site. If by some miracle you decide to do that, I would be very pleased. Thank you very much for being with us this week, and we'll see you again next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.